My name is Sebastian König. I'm going to talk about this mannequin in Blender. Maybe a little bit to introduce myself. So I'm a Blender Foundation certified trainer. I've worked on Tears of Steel 2 years ago. And currently I'm working here in Leipzig at a small studio for VFX and animation. And during this last year, I had worked on a project about this figure. So this is some kind of puppet or a mannequin, like this big, 22 centimeters, and it's from 1526. So it's very old, and it has movable limbs. So the arms and the legs could be moved, and there are not many of these puppets. So there's, I think in total, there's about 8. So there's another one, and they have been created in 1526 by, probably, we don't really know exactly as far as I know, but it was Meister IP. In English, it would be Master IP, which is kind of cool in this LGM. So Master IP has created these puppets, and one of them is exhibited in the Grassi Museum, which is, you can even see it, it's right there, so 500 meters, you can see it from here. And they have this puppet on display, and this is how it looks like. So it's in the museum, it's just standing there, and of course, oops, it's very old. So even though the limbs have been movable once, you cannot do that because it would just break. And it's a nice puppet, but how is it made and what was possible with it? Like, how could you move it? That was a question that they asked. And they collaborated with the University of Leipzig. So the graduate conservator Christian Jürgens, who is here somewhere in the room, hello. He has collaborated with Professor Klaus Bente from the University of Leipzig, and the university has this computer tomographic scanner. So they took this mannequin and put it into this scanner device and have been able to really examine how it was built and what does it look like from the inside. So you can see there are the separate parts and they are hollow in the middle. And there have been strings in it that are holding this puppet together. And already by looking at this, it kind of looks like a rig. So this was the construction that made it movable. But of course, you cannot do that today because it would break. So they made the scan and had this digital data, like a cloud or mesh, point cloud or a giant mesh. And they thought it would be nice maybe if you could move it. I mean, if you have the digital data, you can just manipulate it and move it. And somehow this Professor Klaus Bente, he knew about Blender and he asked me if I could prepare that model for him. And I said, yes, of course. And they gave me the data and it was a really dense mesh. So before I could do anything with that, I had to clean it up. And of course, I would do that in Blender. So that's the point where I have to go to Blender, of course, and then have a look at the data. Okay. So they gave me from the scanner software, they gave them this mesh, and they exported to an OBJ file. So I could import that in Blender as OBJ and then start to clean it up. So if I go here, then I have this OBJ. And it takes a while because it's a really huge mesh. So that's how it looked like. And you can see the detail everywhere. So it's very, very precise scanning method. And this has been even reduced. This was much more detailed and much better. So they already decimated the mesh to make it a little bit more lightweight of course, if you want to animate this, it should not be too hard to compute. So that's why you have to cut down on the density of the mesh. And so my task was to separate these limbs. And if we have a look at that, it looks like if we would have these balls and then the separate limbs. But of course, this is one giant mesh, so I cannot really separate these things easily. I have to really dive into the mesh and select the single vertices and manipulate them in some way. So there are a couple of ways in Blender that you can do that, but all of them are tedious. So it was not a one-click solution. It was just manual, tedious work of selecting separate parts and then deleting the vertices and working with that. So first I separated, first I separated the head and then started to work down to the single limbs and so. So here we have the you can see the hollow body. I'm not going to go too much into detail. I mean, you can already see that it is really, really dense. So it took a while to clean it up. And that's a later stage of the process where I have separated one leg. And then you have these edges where I cut off these balls on the limbs. And then somehow I have to clean it up and make it maybe by an extrusion. Somehow try to close that and separate all the separate parts of the body. And then, of course, the balls that are the joints, I can just create a UV sphere, which is much easier than to try to recreate the original ball. Okay, that took a while, but at some point I had finished the model and had separated everything. And you can see here you have these transition parts between the different limbs. So once I had these separate parts, I could use Rigify, which is a script in Blender that allows me to quite easily create a rig for the mesh so that I could move it. So now we have all these separate parts of the body. And once you rig it, so then you have these things and you can just move them. And thereby you can start animating that. So I had this finished model, and the museum asked me to do a little animation with it because you have it on display in the museum, just like that. And it would be nicer if the audience could see that this was actually a movable thing that could be posed in some way. So that's why they asked me to do a little animation with that. Maybe I can show you the blend file. So, so here's the animation. So it's moving, you can see all the different keyframes, and it was a really nice process in Blender, thanks to Rigify, which made the entire animation process quite nice. And I think I have 5 minutes left or so, so I'm just going to show you the result of that. So that's the animation. So that's just for demoing the model. That is not in the museum. That is just for the internet. But that's the animation that you can see in the museum. That's it. That's the animation. Thanks. Thanks. So currently it's displayed like this. On the right side you have the actual model. On the left side they have this computer monitor. They have a little movie about the historic background of the model. And then at the end they also show this little animation, which apparently people like very much, which is nice for me. But then that was nice, but then I said, okay, now we have this all this digital data, and we have a model, and we have the real thing, so why not use this data and also make it some real thing? So I proposed them to maybe let's do a 3D print of that. Maybe let's see if we can reconstruct the actual puppet. And they agreed to that, which I liked very much. So I did some further cleanup of the mesh, separating the meshes so that they are printable. Once I finished that, I exported that to STL. And these STL files could then be used by the printer. And it was printed as SLS, laser sintering. And that turned out very nice. So SLS is a really nice material. It's very detailed. It has a nice feel and look. So then I had these separate parts. And I could do some experimenting how to combine them. And it turned out it was quite doable with nylon strings. And I just assembled that, and it worked. So I brought it to the museum, and they liked it very much. And the interesting thing is, from what I heard, is that they were wondering why this mannequin has such an enormous butt. Apparently, it has a very huge bottom, and it wasn't clear why, because this was done as an anatomical model, which was used by Albrecht Dürer as well, and he knows proportions. So why give it this enormous thing? So, and the theory was that maybe it was to help the puppet sitting, but you can't test it. If you take the real thing, you break it. But now with this printed model, you can actually verify that yes, it sits. So now it's sitting there, and I have it with me. So that's the thing, and you can pose the limbs, and in this case the arms are a little bit too loose, so they don't stay, yeah, but can try. Come on. Yeah. So it's sitting there. Yeah, thanks. So if you want to, you can come later maybe and have a look. So are there any questions so far?
Are there any questions?
Well, of course, the original mannequin is made from wood. It's carved with extremely detailed limbs. So this is crappy compared to that. So you can move the limbs, but the real thing, you could move the toes. Oh, sorry, yeah. So this is crappy compared to the actual thing. So the real thing made of wood, you can move the toes and the fingers even. It's totally insane. It's really cool. So, but this is like a just an approximation to it. Nah. And that's SLS, the material.
And the size is the same size?
It's the same size. That's the actual size. It's 22.5 centimeters. So they're really tiny, the fingers.
Yeah, one more question. Sorry.
Yeah, yes, basically yes. No, the first exports that they did, they were really enormous meshes, 300 megabytes or so. And I imported them to Blender and tried to decimate it there, but it didn't. It was too huge. It didn't work. So they decimated the mesh in the scanner software thing. I was thinking maybe to decimate it even more here. So maybe if I briefly go here and take one of these, maybe just the body. Of course, I could go ahead and use the decimate modifier, which now works really great. But when I did this cleanup of the mesh, that was 2 years ago. And I think the decimate modifier has been improved since then. But of course, I could go ahead and get rid of some of the detail. But then you would also lose just the surface. So, and I would wanted to keep that. And I didn't want to retopo it because that would have been just as tedious.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you.